This is This Week in Perspective with me, Adam Simbeye. The Minister for Finance and Economic Planning, Dr. Philip Mpango, has presented the government budget framework for 2017-2018 to the National Assembly meeting in Dodoma, estimated at shillings 31.6 trillion, which is an increase of 7.4% from the 2016-2017 budget, which was at 29.5 trillion. To discuss the generality of this budget and whatever is involved in this, with me are today on my right, Gilead Terry from Tanzania Private Sector Foundation. Next is Professor Haji Semboja from the Department of Economics, University of Dar es Salaam. Next is Professor Prosper Ngoi, Mzumbe University Business School. This is the Dar es Salaam campus. Last but not least, Dr. Blandina Kilama from REPOA. By the way, I always fail to give the long name of REPOA.
It's just
REPOA. It's just REPOA. Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
As I said in passing, let's try and look at the budget presented or the framework and see whether there are things there that the country and you especially see as positive or negative, and what should be done. But there it is. It may end up different from what was presented when the minister finally presents the or lays the budget on the table. So let's start. We'll give justice to the discussion. I'll start with you, Professor Ngoi. Do you think, or in your view, is the 2017-2018 proposed budget realistic and achievable?
Mm-hmm. Well, for the sake of background, you can see the proposed budget is to the tune of around 1.6 trillion, around that. Mm-hmm. Now, to see whether it's achievable or not, you have to make a comparison, and maybe make a comparison just to the last one, which was 29.5. Now, by February 2017, yes, in terms of disbursement, you know, and let's look at the category of development expenditure, we are told only around 34% was released. And, you know, if you go, if you assume that it was supposed to be equal monthly disbursement of, yes, equal amounts, yes, by February, we should have disbursed around 66.3% of the budget. Now, if you have disbursed only 34%, and that's development expenditure,
yes,
this tells you that there is a problem somewhere. And according to the Minister for Finance, he's saying the problem is a delay in disbursement of donor funds. But of course, also domestic collection has been rather low compared to, according to the Minister. No? So whether the 31.6% is realistic, it means can we really achieve it? And the key question is, if you have not been able to collect around, because indications show that really we may not really achieve 29.5. Some estimates somewhere are saying maybe the most you can collect will be maybe 26 trillion, 25 if you struggle so much. So there is this huge gap.
Yes.
Now, also the question of saying whether this 31% is realistic and achievable, you know, the ground has also shifted, you know, the economic situation, the situation of the businesses in terms of revenues. Mm. Which are now required to fill the gap, because now you need, I think, 1.7 trillion more shillings or something like that in order to achieve this new figure. But then I would guess that the economic situation, the private sector situation where revenue are going to be collected, yes, both tax and non-tax revenue, really the ground has shifted to the worst situation, really. We have seen businesses struggling. We have seen a lot of foreclosures, the one in the past 1 year, financial year. We have seen companies coming with a lot of
as well as retrenchment.
Yeah, yeah, and retrenchment number of companies. We have seen, you know, I'll say negative indicators in terms of expecting to get more tax revenue. So in this context, I would say it will be really hard work to be able to raise this new revenue from taxes. But also remember, after tax, you have non-tax revenue. Mm. You could see, for example, if you see what is happening in the mining sector, well, it depends, for example, the question of exporting of I don't know how they call it technically, mm-hmm. but then, you know, the acacia gold thing. It depends. It may also affect really the tax that we may, the tax and untaxed revenue that we may get from the mining sector. Mm-hmm. But also remember, after the you know, this internal revenue, we have external revenue. This is a country that partly also depends on donor funding. So in order to achieve that 31.6%, mm-hmm. there is also a component from donor funding in terms of loan, in terms of aid. Now you could see also the ground has shifted fundamentally. We have discussed Brexit mm-hmm. for quite a long time, which in my view, I think, may partly disturb aid that we expect, let's say, from the EU and such a thing. So,
or from the UK too?
Yeah, from the UK too. So broadly speaking, I would say, really, it does not seem to be realistic given the situation. So remember, this is just a proposal. If we come into our senses, we may scale it down. And I think that it's not sinful to scale it down. Nobody has said that this year's budget has to be bigger than last year's.
Yes, it's not cast in stone, as it were.
It should not end at last.
Yes, okay. Before I come to you, Professor Semboja, let me ask the young man here from the private sector. You heard Professor refer to an aspect of the private sector here, either winding up, life is difficult there. So do you think this budget is favorable to you, to the private sector?
I mean, I think there are key concerns, especially with the performance of the previous budget, and I think they are quite legitimate. If we say only 34% of the development budget has been achieved, that means there's around more than 60% that has not been achieved, 66%. And most of the time in development budget, it's usually large-scale projects, it's usually construction, and which most of it is being undertaken, most of which is being undertaken by the private sector. So this is a huge chunk of money that was supposed to go into the private sector, especially from the public coffers, to support job creation, to support infrastructure, to support supplies of cement and other construction materials. That did not happen for the last year. Mm. So is it bad for the private sector? Yes, it is bad, and I think we need to look into it. So there will be a challenge, there will be an outcry in that section of the economy, and I think it's important to follow it up to see how that impact is. Now, coming back to the current budget frameworks, there are sort of two ways to look at it. When you have a big deficit budget, it is worrying, especially to the plans and government plans that the government has put in place. Mm. On the other side, it could be a signal of a very pragmatic withdrawal of government from very specific features and sort of scaling of private sector to come in and take up those roles. Mm-hmm. But that is not automatic. You know, if you have a 31 trillion, 32 trillion budget and you can only sort of foot 25, 26, that gap has to be sort of filled in with someone else. And you have to have proper incentive to make sure that someone else could come in and foot that bill.
Traditionally used to be the development partners.
Exactly. But now we need new frameworks. We need a public-private partnership. We need to open up our policies and laws to invite people that can fund these projects and these programs. And they're there. There are people that can come in and explore public-private partnership and actually undertake some of these development projects. The only bigger challenge we have is that our policies are not as pragmatic as how the economy out there in the world is moving. And if we are going with the deficit budget, as well as very conservative sort of economic policies, that's a self-defeat.
I'll come to you, madam. I mean, people shouldn't complain that I bring you last, but I'll come to you. You're the only lady, I should give you more chance. Professor, is the investment climate and the policy, as the young man says, really pragmatic to bring in resources that may bridge the gap of the deficit in our budget proposals?
Well, what I can say,
you can still go and answer the first question. Is it realistic?
I think the first question has been answered.
Yes.
In a way. Maybe I can take another different opinion.
Fine.
That this is a budget of a poor and a developing nation. This is a budget, it's a transitional budget. It's the first budget for this government. Now, it's typical that you have some ambitious programs in terms of how to collect the revenues mm-hmm. and how to finance those government activities. The current proposed budget is a pro rata, is based on the norm for the last 10, 15 years. They have just put it the 10%, 15% increase of the previous. So it's been pro rata type of budget. So it's not new. So it's realistic in the sense that it's a standard procedure. Of simply
adding 10%.
And so that's it's realistic in the sense that we are used for not performing. Okay, so
I want you to explain that.
Yeah, I mean, when we are saying we are not performing, I can say at least we were doing better during CAPA's regime. Oh, at least when you can have what was planned and what was endorsed by the parliament and what was disembursed was the same. But with the second regime, what was planned and what was accepted by the parliament was different.
But you mean the fourth, fourth phase?
Yes. Yeah. If you look at it carefully. So there is nothing new.
In this way,
because it's just a continuation, it's a transition. Now, maybe what will be coming new is the fact that it was a standard fashion that you have the original budget like this one, and then you present it to the members of parliament, and the members of parliament come with additional request. Mm-hmm. So, and finally, always it's all adjusted upwards.
And not the downward.
No. And typically, when it is adjusted upwards, we know that you cannot adjust upward the projected financing, means of financing. So we used to have two problems. One problem is to discuss, we are always, when we are saying a budget, we are discussing about how to spend the money. But when we are saying a budget, not many are engaged in understanding the mobilization of the resources. And when we talk about the government mobilization of resources, we are looking at it. The Tanzania Revenue Authority, it's not Tanzania Revenue Authority. It is Tanzania Tax Authority. Now, when you talk about the revenues...
That's a very interesting distinction, isn't it?
When you talk about revenues, you have two components, a tax and then non-tax. Now, if you look at the data for the last year, or this current year, the budget performance based on the collection of the TRI was about 95%. So what was projected and what was realized from the government figures was that TRI performed because they managed to collect about 95% of their government tax revenues. Now, the problem which we're having now is not based on the taxes, but other sources of financing, which include borrowing from the internal sources mm-hmm. and also expecting funds flow of the resources from outside. Now, borrowing from inside was somehow so automatic but constrained by a number of factors. But now getting funds from outside mm-hmm. has been very complicated because of many reasons. Two major reasons. One major reason is internal, that we did not perform in terms of the previous implementation of the agreed development projects. So what we did was different from what they were expecting us, so they delayed. But also, understandably, is last year or this year. We are getting the funds from development partners, and these funds are coming from the taxes and the incomes which are generated in developed states. Mm. Now, these developed states have had problems last year. The growth of many European countries were below 2-3%. And they had their Brexit, as you understand. Mm. They had problems of the Middle East.
Migrations.
Mm. And therefore, they had to look at the internal affairs as opposed. And this is now serious this year, because both the British and the Americans, they are going to concentrate on their own businesses. So we are left talking about getting external finances from the Eastern Bloc. Now, but here we're talking about external resources. By definition, you have both grants and loans. Mm. Now, there are no problems of getting the loans as long as you can prove.
For example, from the World Bank or IMF?
Yes, as long as you can prove that these are monies which are going to be invested in productive areas. And
They don't look back. The money they gave us, whether we have really fulfilled
That's the reason we are not getting more funds now, because we are not disciplined. Okay, those are the external reasons. But the internal reasons are known. Okay, clearly the tax regime, the revenue generation regime for a country like Tanzania, it's a shame that we depend solely on taxes. And now, if you look at the Tanzanians, and the nature of many of the Tanzanians are not taxable. My friend is coming from the private sector. We understand what has been happening during the whole of the last year. The private sector has been choked. It cannot move.
Is it because as a policy, we have not really expanded the tax base?
I can't recommend for more taxes now.
Mm-hmm. What would you recommend?
I would recommend to look for the non-tax revenues. Now there are different areas. You know, this our government, when you talk about the non-tax revenues, these are incomes which can be generated by the fact that the government owns and operates some productive areas like TANESCO. Okay, like STAMICO. Like TBDC and other public company, TPA. Okay, all these ones, they have to operate as corporate entity to make money, to make enough transfers. But also, Tanzania is a natural resource country.
Yeah.
There is nothing wrong, and this is what is acceptable. We've been trained and coached by the Norwegians and other nations. Norwegians, they own petroleum. It's the state oil company. It's the government owning the oil sector. It's operating on behalf of its own nationals. Now, Tanzania is much richer than Norway in terms of natural resources. We have even included uranium in this country, not to mention gas, not to mention copper, not to mention mining gold, something like gold.
We control it.
Yes, but yes, that's the point. Our way, I think this is a question of policy, whether Tanzanians can now come back to the 70s and think about the role of the state to own and operate these strategic areas of minerals like uranium, gas, petroleum, mm-hmm. not necessarily full 100% ownership, mm-hmm. but in a participatory model. Yes. Now, if you look at the all nations with the natural resources,
yes.
the only and the best mode of development, it's only when you own it, you operate. There is no way you can depend on taxes. No country in the world with the resources.
Mm.
They have transformed their economies using that model.
Not taxes. All right. Now, we come back to you, Professor. Thank you for your explanation. Let's hear from the only young lady here. I mean, there's a question somewhere there, but we don't have to address this. What's your take on this, in the whole question of the budget? First, you followed Professor Ngowi, you followed Professor Haji Zemboja, you followed what the private sector representative here, Lydia Terry. Now, you are neither a private sector, no academic, but
academic.
You are an academic, of course. So what did you say to this budget?
Thanks. I will go a little bit outside of what they've said, but
yes.
still to stick to the budget discussion. In a way, linked to what Professor Zemboja just said, we know the figures. The figures are out. Now the question is, what are we going to do to make sure we are getting these figures in as much as we've been facing challenges for over the decade to get these figures? And for me, I'm looking at this more of an internal kind of like evaluation within the government itself. And what do I mean? So we have the private sector that is supposed to create a lot of jobs. And with that, we're expecting a lot of revenue from that. But then we do have regulators. Then for me, the question is, what is the job of regulators? Do they have KPIs, key performance indicators, that allow them to be given incentives when they're actually facilitating businesses, or they don't have those? Because so far from what the discussion is saying is, our regulators are not doing that. Our regulators have been closing and closing and closing businesses. Mm-hmm. So the question is, if we look, let's say, at TFDA, okay? So if I walk into TFDA today and I ask, so how many companies or how many businesses did you facilitate this year? How many jobs have you created? And at the end, how much revenue has been generated from that? That would be the kind of discussion whereby whether the numbers we are receiving are too big or too small, they will become a little bit different.
Or they just concentrate on closing.
Yeah, and you're right. No, no, no. If you're a regulatory authority, yes. Actually your overarching a way of doing things and everything that you want to do should be, in as much as a business person is saying, I want to operate my business, for the regulatory authority, they should understand we want to have a bigger economy whereby everybody will have a job, and then we will have revenues. Because they also have to understand, all these regulatory authorities, their payments are coming from, okay, he called it a tax authority, the payments are coming from there. So they should actually
facilitate
and have more and more businesses that are able to provide more revenue. Mm. I'll give a small example. For instance, there is some pharmaceutical work that we did at Rapport. The question would be, for instance, we ask, how long does it take you
When you say take you, you are referring to the
Tanzania. Business. No,
or to the Tanzania food and drug?
I'm referring to a business.
Yes.
If I am a business person,
yes.
And I'm taking my sample for testing mm-hmm. at TFDA. Mm-hmm. My first question will be, how long will it take me to get approval that my sample is good? Because only with that is when I can start production. Without that, then I stay.
Yes.
If I go to TFDA, they clear everything within 2 weeks, that's very good. 2 months, very good. A year?
Too bad.
Really bad. If it takes 1.5 years,
yes.
Really, really bad. So it's one thing we're saying we're facing challenges, but if we do a really internal evaluation, then yes. We can understand like how long does this take?
Mm.
Or maybe the other way of looking of the same thing is then for TFDA now, let's say, it's just the organization I thought very quickly. They can tell us how many applications have they received. Let's say if it's this for the sampling of some production that person has to say, oh, we've received this many. Okay. Mm-hmm. Of these that you have received, how many did you respond to? It's one thing to get 10,000 applications, and then you simply respond to 2,000. Mm-hmm. 10,000, did you respond to 10,000? And
what
then when you're responding,
yes, yes.
Exactly, within what time frame? And did you provide all the required information that will facilitate, you know, having this business on? Because it's one thing when we're saying we want to have more revenue, but we are busy closing. We have to facilitate, because that's the role. And that's, I thought that would be an angle I would think about.
That's
about
very
it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
You're laughing. You want to come in, young man? Professor?
Actually, exactly as she's saying, and in the context of budget, and this is the fiscal policy now, fiscal policy and fiscal policy instruments. Because we have tended in most of our budgets, really, as Professor said, to concentrate on collecting more and more and more, and I think this is an issue with private sector. I've been doing some studies on taxation, and among the outcry, multitudes of taxes, high tax rates, every year increasing taxes. That's why I think Professor was very correct saying, and I've said it elsewhere, that really the key issue now, this time around, is not adding new taxes or increasing rates. And I'm afraid, in order to move from 29.5 to 31.6, we have this tendency of increasing taxes, types of taxes and the rates. This is wrong. This is wrong, especially this time around, where the private sector is broadly constrained. We have seen a lot of what you call a contractionary fiscal policy, you know, high tax rate, multitude of tax and all this. And so it's exactly what Dr. Brandina is saying. You know, the policy environment around taxes this time around, if you're not careful, really, we may kill instead of reviving businesses. Mm-hmm. I think I've said somewhere, if we are bold enough, we could make an experiment, lower tax rates, reduce types of taxes, you may indeed realize more revenue.
How about reducing interest rate as well?
Sorry? Yeah, now that we move to the monetary policy. We have seen it a little bit, the monetary policy. The central bank reduced the lending rate from 16% to 12%. I'm not sure how it has played out in the economy. It's one thing having those things on paper, but then it's another thing having them in place. So it's good that she brings those examples of business environment.
And as far as the public sector is concerned, there's so many, not so many, but there are a number of these regulatory agencies. There's no kind of consolidation so that you know you're only going to one window, but you have to move from one window to the other, delays and all this. Now, you wanted to react here. Come in, please.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a number of things to react on, and I'll try to be very quickly. I think on the issue of financial services, that sort of the central bank trying to intervene, try to ease the liquidity challenge is very crucial. Because now the banks can get the money a little bit cheaper from the central bank as a lender of last resort. And they can lend it to the public. But the question is, that is a bit of a small measure compared to if they could lend the money from their own deposits. So the interest rates will not necessarily go down because now they have to pay someone else the loan. But on the issue of regulation, that's I think it couldn't be said anyhow better. If we want to have the private sector quite vibrant in the economy, and we wanted to create jobs and pay taxes, we are supposed to facilitate it. And you're not supposed to constrain it. One just little point. In Kenya, for example, the only authority that can close a business is the court, is the judiciary. So if NEMC, for example, today, or TFDA has a problem with a particular company, they take them to court, then the court actually closes that business down.
Decides to close.
But here in Tanzania, I think every regulatory authority has the authority to close down a business. A business
or charge them.
Exactly. That pays taxes and or employs people.
Commission.
Yes. Exactly. So that framework is very important. And I think we come back to pragmatism and that approach of giving regulators KPIs to support private sector, to support them doing business so that they can pay taxes and government gets its funds to fund the budget. Is very important. And I've been speaking, for example, recently with colleagues from France. I think we have had a very vibrant week
during
of
the
investors,
French
week.
Exactly.
And for example, an issue of railways. You have companies in the world that are big enough, liquid enough to come here and support the construction of a standard gauge railway. Mm-hmm. Might not be the whole of it, but a certain section of it. So you have two ways to go about it. You might decide for yourself to tax your businesses and pay for the railway, mm-hmm. or go into a joint venture or a public-private partnership mm-hmm. where a private company pays for it, then you work out a mechanism on how to pay it all the way through. The easy way about it is that you don't have to pay it 110% from your own pocket.
But you get the money to pay that.
You actually, the arrangement of operationalizing it over time mm-hmm. pays for itself, be it 25 years, be it 30 years. And mm-hmm. that's the whole essence of public-private partnership, mm-hmm. where you have a private partner coming in with capital, mm-hmm. try to provide a social solution, mm-hmm. and have a policy framework where everyone benefits out of it without you trying to get your hands on 10 different projects that makes yourself, you know, expand your budget in 10-15% mm-hmm. every year, and end up not being able to achieve it because you tax the private sector, and the private sector cannot work because it is heavily burdened by unfavorable business environment.
Maybe I start to be corrected. Maybe you'll handle it. I read somewhere where the minister says part of this budget in terms of development projects will be focused on the railway infrastructure.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, do we have the money? I mean, that's as we have been saying. Where is the money?
Yeah.
Yes, Professor.
Maybe let me discuss the first issue, of failure of the government to release the funds.
Yes.
And I'm not sure we have to find the reasons, because one of the reasons can be explained that we lack finances. Those people promised us to send money. Mm. They never send the money on time. It can be a reason. But also, I need to get an explanation. There is a difference when you talk about, you are discussing about quarterly, this kind of discussion. Mm. That is a good when you talk about recurrent. But when you talk about development, it's another story. I mean, most of these projects take 3 to 5 years. So you're not discussing about the budget over the 1 year. You're talking about the budget for 5 years. Now, for this particular year, we don't know how much planned by design was supposed to be getting money from the government coffer. Okay, it might be true that there is a failure because of the fact that time has not come yet for the release of the funds which are needed for specific purchases, especially when we have a huge imports of the capital machinery equipment in the railway systems. Mm-hmm. It takes a lot of time, and it doesn't take this. It's not done by quarterly. It's done by allotment. I mean, we are talking about whether what time are we expecting to purchase those bigger capital equipment from either Asia or Turkey or China for that.
Or Europe.
Or Europe. That's one story. But another story, which I think we have to look at it, is the fact that there are many avenues of financing these projects. Remember, we are talking about infrastructure projects in Tanzania. Tanzania is part of the global village. So many of these projects are not only intended to cater for the interests of Tanzanians. They are intended to cater for the interests of all the neighboring countries, connecting with the other external world, like Asia, India. So when the Asia, Japan, or China, they are thinking about trading with Zambia, they also have to think about transporting this from Dar es Salaam port to Zambia. So Dar es Salaam, from Dar es Salaam to Lusaka, is part of the global world. So the people, they can come here to invest. He's giving a good example. I do not think that we do not have a policy. We have a public partnership policy. We have a law. We have other macro policies in place. We have other sector policies in place. They're good, but they're not implementable. One of the reasons, look here, these are investors. They are very smart. Of course, they keep monitoring, making some evaluations, and what is happening now inside the country. Now, they need the political stability. They need the physical regime to be stable. I mean, if they hear about what has happened to Acacia, that these are investors, these are not hooligans. These are professional people. They have entered.
They've been in business for years.
Yes, they've been in the business.
And in many countries.
Not only in Tanzania. And you have papers with them, contracts, licenses with them. And then exporting concentrate is just part of their business. Mm-hmm. Now, it is our own fault because of the lack of understanding. We termed it mchanga. Then become it is a problem. But that's not mchanga.
I mean,
those are minerals.
In English, you mean sandy.
No, yes.
We've termed it into sand.
Which is not. You see? Now, they have got Acacia and Biahulu. They have two processes. One process is they do it there internal. Another process, they have to expand it. They have to export it. Now, if you stop it, it means they're informing all other investors about what has been happening to their firm and what are the potential effects. Whether if people are coming to invest in the infrastructure like the railway, and you do the same, you say, okay, we stop the passenger, and you are only allow the cargo. And for investors, that is an uncertainty.
Oh, you don't bring material from outside. You use your local material.
Local materials, and the investors are there to make money, to make profit, of course. They will agree with you with the least cost type of technologies. Mm. And for that matter, if you have the least cost technology in your country, they will adopt it. And that one should be done by design, not by default. Okay, now what has happened is that they can come here conditionally. If they know you are civilized, you'll never change the rule of the game, that you know that you have policies, you have laws, okay? But if they realize that you are unpredictable, there is no way of communication, they will simply stay and wait until when there are things are stable. And I think I can safely say that precisely for the mining sector, and even for the petroleum, we have not performed for the last 10 years. Okay, those companies which were attracted came to Tanzania, they still remain the same.
No expansion, nothing.
No expansion. You see.
But okay, Professor.
But what I'm coming to,
yes,
it's now the relationship between the government expenditure in terms of the development, mm-hmm, and the other supporting policies to facilitate, to promote the private sector. There must be a good synergy, mm-hmm, between the development of the private sector, which is vital and is the engine of the growth, and the supporting engine from the government. These two have to work together. It is very, very unfortunate.
With the government involvement, of course.
Yes, I'm talking about the government involvement. Relationships should be good, mm, and we should support each other.
Okay.
The policies are clear.
Mm.
And what is the current government is doing? I think this is we have to look at it from this perspective. This is our first budget whereby the government allocate about 40% of its revenues to development. Mm-hmm. It's a big switch. Okay, now. The government intends to invest in infrastructure facilities. And that's a very good supporting way of the private sector to ease in, maybe to reduce costs of doing business in this country,
mm,
in the transportation. Okay, that's very good. That's the government can do, mm, okay? Now, but we have to understand that it takes time for these investment projects to be realized, okay? And another thing we have to understand is that based on the previous experience, many of the budgets have been almost listing the same kind of projects for the last 10 years and no concrete steps been taken. You'll hear about, we are now contracting the designer, we have now opened a tender. We have now come to an agreement that their funds are coming, and we have these projects, which are known. I don't want to mention them. They've been there in their books, the government budgets, for the last 10 to 15 years, especially in the infrastructure, and especially in the energy sector, not in the infrastructure. When you talk about the roads, we've been performing. Okay, but
not so far in the energy sector.
Now, what I understand for the current regime is the fact that they do not talk.
Yes.
They want action. They want the results. Mm-hmm. So it's bitter. I have to warn my friends who are now holding these good positions that the current president is after results, not after processes.
Before you come in, young man, I wanted to.
Our thinking is that they have got the signals. Our thinking is that we want to see the railway, the connection from Dar es Salaam to Dodoma, which now takes about how many hours?
23, 24.
No, from Dodoma to Dar es Salaam by road, it takes not less than 9 hours.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
But with the train, if it comes up within the next 2 years, it will take less than 5 hours, and that will be good for the economy. And that is what is we are waiting for the private sector.
Mm-hmm.
The private sector looks for that one. Then it's possible for us to think about investing industries in Dodoma. If you have the power, if you have the water, if you have the infrastructure, people will be indifferent between investing in Dar es Salaam or Tanga, Morogoro for that matter.
Ombeya for that matter. Don't forget where I come from.
And investing in Singida, in Papua, and in Dodoma, because this is where you have the agriculture sector. And the key sectors which we are now searching, they are related to raw material, especially the agricultural raw material. So if the government can support that one, we are now looking forward to see how the private sector is going to react by inviting private sector investors in agro-based type of the industries.
Right. Professor, I just want to draw your attention when you were talking about acacia and exporting concentrates, whatever. The president has appointed a special committee to look into this. Yeah? So let's hope the committee will come up with something positive, and that may resolve the question of the relationship between exporting the concentrates and the contract and what is involved in that. Now, time is really going to be against us. Professor, so what are specific budget priorities? What are the specific priorities for this budget? And do you think they will be able to be, they will be implemented with the budget allocated, with the background of the fact that we may not be able to raise the money as required?
Mm-hmm. You know, looking at the framework, it seems really infrastructure is going to have a huge chunk of the budget, yes, broadly speaking. But then among the priorities, you also have the move to Dodoma as among the priorities. Yes. So I won't talk about that. But then on the infrastructure, which again, Professor said so well, I think it's good that we focus on infrastructure because this is a country that has huge infrastructure deficit. But I think what we are maybe not getting correct, we are focused a lot on what we call hard infrastructure, on the roads and railways and all this. Mm. We have forgotten the soft infrastructure part of it.
What is the soft infrastructure?
Soft infrastructure would include the telecoms, internet, you know, the broadbands and all this. Analysis somewhere has been done, and to tell you, in terms of value, the value that travels in the soft infrastructure, in our internet, in our television, and all this, is bigger than the huge volumes that we are seeing in our railways and roads. Remember, we are in the knowledge economy. Mm-hmm. Knowledge economy where ideas are transacted. Think about the transactions that are taking place on between banks and banks. All those are really functions of...
Between one telecom, M-Pesa, exactly. Tigo-Pesa,
Yeah. Think of the e-commerce and all this. And I think we have tended to think that infrastructure, roads, railways, ports, airports, yes, they are, but really there is more than that. We have forgotten, in my view. I don't think that we have put a lot of emphasis on soft infrastructure. So in terms of that, whether it's going to be achieved, again, it's a function of getting the funds. And I think, again, we have gotten it wrong because, you know, the government has really focused a lot on implementing those things. While these days, really, across the world, we have what we call infrastructure PPP, you know, infrastructure public-private partnership, where, as they have said here, the private sector, both local and foreign, could be invited to put on those kind of stuff. And there are a lot of models. And a number of studies have been done on infrastructure PPP. The policy are there. Regulation is there. Some institutions, individuals, including me, actually, have written on PPP, yeah, on PPP infrastructure. I wrote one on PPP infrastructure and local government authority, where we are saying, really, local government does not need to find money to build the bus terminals and all this. At Msambu, for example, I did a case study of Msambu, where we are seeing private sector injecting in money, constructing modern, up-to-date, state-of-the-art facility in terms of bus terminal, while the government, and that is local government, just provided land. You know, so I think these models are everywhere. You see again Mwanza City. I don't know how they call it, the mall over there. Mm-hmm. In Mbeya, there is one between CRDB and the local government authority. I did it in Tandaimba, I did it in so many places. We actually done a lot of studies on cashew nut, where local government authorities, again, are saying, we don't need really to struggle to find the money. You know, let the private sector bring money, we give them land, and the government now releases itself of the stress to find all this money. And Ngozi Nsuse, you know, has done a study and actually given a publication on PPP. And I think, as all of you know, it's not that we don't know those things. It's not like we don't have knowledge on those kind of stuff. I think the question is implementation.
There's abundant knowledge out there.
Yes.
Plenty of knowledge out there.
Yeah, so on whether it's going to, the priorities really are going to be achieved. Mm. Again, it depends on our approach on, for example, on funding and all this. And of course, on funding, you go back to business environment, you go back to taxes and tax revenue and all kind of stuff.
Yeah. Okay, I know, Professor, you have written so much and you have said many times in this program. Investors, and I'm sure Professor Semboja has also agreed, investors want certainty.
Mm-hmm.
They don't like uncertainty.
Sure.
Now, very quickly,
mm-hmm.
are they certain with the situation in Tanzania to come and invest? One. Two, which we all ask, mm-hmm. answer, where is the money going to come from? Mm-hmm. Very quickly.
Yeah, you know, the question of certainty, that is predictability, is very important. Mm-hmm. On the 3rd of January 2015, mm-hmm. some almost 9 months before election, mm-hmm. last election, I wrote a piece in my column saying there will be wait and see. When new governments come, normally there is wait and see from the captains and titans of the industry. Should we invest or should we not invest? Depending on the kind of regime that is going to come. And I wrote this 10 months before election. So the wait and see would be, will it be the ruling party that is coming back or opposition? Now, of course, it turned out it is the ruling party that came back.
Yes.
Now, again, the question is, within the ruling party, who within the ruling party? Yes, we know who. Now, the question is, what will be the policies? What will be the regulations and all this? And I think it's, I see, you know, talking to business community, you see still some uncertainty, you see still some unpredictable policies, legal, regulatory framework. But the most important, I think, is, there's an announcement, you know, that are coming. Exactly. You know, those kind of stuff. Which I think from policy point of view, from a predictability point of view, and this comes from everywhere, not only from president, from ministers, from DC, from wherever. For example, the other time I had a discussion on banning of the, such as they are called, the Viroba thing,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
This is a typical case, again, of unpredictable business environment at its locus. You know, the problem is, I think we tend to look at the business environment at this big, big level. And I have a conflict of interest here. I've been chairing the Investment Climate Monitoring Committee mm-hmm. at Tanzania Investment Center, TIC,
mm-hmm.
where I know, really, question of predictability, it's an issue. You talk to a number of people, they'll tell you, no.
All right.
Yeah.
We are left with very few limited time. Very quickly, Mama, where do you think the money will come from, if you can respond to that?
That's a good question.
And then, not only that, because the last question was going to be, what are the challenges that you think the government is going to face with this 2017-2018 budget? Very quickly,
let's go around. Yeah, sure. Thanks. I think just to pick from where I ended, but then taking up the discussion that has continued. First of all, when we are saying it's very important to send just one voice,
mm-hmm.
and then everybody else can act upon that one voice.
Yes.
But if there are too many voices, then it becomes noise.
Yes.
So I think that the first work will be around that. Like, yes. Hey, all right, where do we want to go? Okay, so
there's only one person who says it all.
No, not one person. It can be 2,000, 200,000, mm-hmm. 20 million, all of them just saying the same thing.
Okay.
Let's say all of us are saying our budget is 32 million.
Yes.
Good. Fact.
Do you think everybody is talking about industrialization and industrial economy
and
by 2025?
And that's where I'm going.
Oh.
So second will be, if this is our budget, and then we have our vision, and we have our five-year development plan. Mm. And in the five-year development plan, which is part of what you said, is we're looking into industrialization. And so what are the things that are important to be done to make sure we are really only facilitating industrialization, nothing else? Meaning, there's challenges that we've been reporting
yes.
and around the discussion.
Yeah.
Would be not important. Because the problem is, we are saying, if you don't have a destination, any road will just take you somewhere.
Yes.
It will take you somewhere,
yes.
not to your destination.
Yes.
But if we all say, no, we want this number, and with this we want so-and-so people to be employed, we want so-and-so revenue to be collected. So TRA will be talking about the revenue they want, and then all the regulatory authority will be facilitating making sure the numbers that are coming up are supported. Because otherwise you'll be shooting yourself in the leg. Like one is trying to increase the numbers of employees and the other one is like, no, my work is just to close down the business.
I think you have really posed some challenges there, and the powers that be will have heard you towards the last statement. Very quickly, where will the money come from?
I think it comes from the challenge? It comes from the private sector. And it comes from the private sector because of two particular reasons. One, at the moment, the total amount of money that the private sector is being lent is around 17 trillion, all banks. And this is about less than 5 million people, Tanzanian people who have access to commercial banks. We have a population, a working population of around 22, 23 million. So we have 60% of our economy still in the shadows, and they still have this money. And we are not doing anything to bring them. Exactly. So Indonesia, they tried to do this mainstreaming thing since last year, September. Guess what they realized? 90% of the GDP has been collected. The figures that they had were around 20% of what actually the real economy was. So I think the private sector has the money. There still needs to be a lot of formalization, a lot of mainstreaming and getting people to the center and participate in the economy. The second thing, it's favorable policy, supportive business environment, and this is very important. And I just want to leave you with one example. So this country for the last 40 years, I think, before the 2000, the fertilizer market was largely government. So they would purchase in bulk, sell with everyone else, deliver to the districts, and they'd sell the districts to the farmers. Exactly. And that skyrocketed the prices of fertilizers in the country, made productivity go low, adoption of fertilizer for per individual farmer went down. And in the 2000, we started reforms, trying to get the private sector in, trying to get competition in. And, you know, some companies have even invested up to $100 million, not only in storage, but in blending of very specific fertilizer in very specific years later down the line. We have made huge progress, huge consumption, huge productivity in particular areas. Guess what happens? There comes a new regulation that says now fertilizer should be procured in bulk. So coming back to the same thing, and this is just February this year, after 15, 20 years of private sector investment and competitiveness and availability of fertilizer in the country, then we are taking this farmer back to square one. And this is exactly what we are saying are favorable policies.
Was the was the private sector not involved in providing advice before this regulating came up?
Not at all.
All right. Mm-hmm. Very quickly, Professor.
Now,
we can wind it up now. Where will the money come from? You heard from this young man, we heard from Bernadette. But maybe you should come up with the one or two challenges that this government is going to face with this budget.
I think the challenge is known. We are depending on the private sector, and at the same time, we are constraining it. So, where are you going to get the money? The government have their own ways of managing their own productive activities in these companies. I think it's high time now to think how best to use these resources. Now, at the moment, you cannot run this the way they are now running it. They have to be allowed, like TANESCO, to operate as a corporate entities. If they continue to be as departments of the ministries,
yes.
No way, we are not going to get
no. All right.
Okay. So we are constraining the private sector.
Yes.
We are not performing in terms of our own productive sectors. So we have some problems.
And we should move away from the dependent from on the taxation as our
The Tanzanians they have reached that. It's not only Tanzania, by the way, Prof. I mean, other countries have started thinking about searching for alternative ways of financing non-government, non-tax revenues, no taxes.
Yeah. We have not touched the question of the government, as part of this budget, borrowing from domestic sources to finance treasury bonds.
And,
but give us one challenge as a response.
The major challenge is, again, borrowing from domestic market is really squeezing out the private sector. That really seems to be the issue. Because government is a giant. It has political and economic muscles, so banks and financial institutions are likely to listen it more than the private sector. So even actually interests may even go high. So if the government borrows, and I'm told it intends to borrow maybe twice as much as it borrowed last year, if that is the case, even if that is not the case, so long as it borrows more from the private sector, domestic, now you automatically squeeze out the private sector in the sense that access to finance to private sector may be a little bit compromised. Mm-hmm. Yet this is the engine of your economic growth, which is supposed to be generating, you know, the revenues and the taxes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So of course, the other thing that we have not touched is austerity economics. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the government has gone too much austere. You know, a lot of cost cutting. If the government is not spending,
tightening of the belt, as
exactly. It was, yeah. If the government is not spending, collecting but not spending, you also really constrain the private sector, because at the end of the day, when the government spends, there's goods and services will be, if everything goes okay, will be really supplied by the private sector. But then, if you have this constraining, and I think in the budget guideline, if I've not gone through it very clearly, but I think there is a section of government to government businesses where we are likely to see government transacting with the government.
Yeah. I forgot to ask, which is very important, and I'm sure my director would allow me to exceed at least 3 or 4 minutes, whoever would like to answer. Is this budget really pro-poor and pro-gender sensitivity? Very quickly. I mean, it's not necessarily you because you're a lady, but gender is an issue which covers everybody. And is it really pro-poor?
No, it is in the short run, it's not pro-poor. But in the long run, given the effects of what the government is doing in terms of the development expenditure, this will help very much the poor to reach the markets whenever it's possible. It's very neutral when you talk about pro-gender, because the railway will cater for all gender.
All right. you have heard the people that talk out there, people say, complaining that life is so tight, there's no money. Is it true? And then you come.
Yeah, it's true that people are complaining, but also I think it's also true that really liquidity is an issue. And you look this through some indicators, looking at the businesses, the way businesses have been performing, the way businesses have been really struggling. Sales really dropping, and of course when you sales volume, sales revenue, and profit and all this. Yeah. So, and of course there are a number of issues in here, including the general business environment again. Okay. If people are not spending, if the government is not spending, people are not getting income, and so they are not spending. So you have this multiply effect at the end of the day.
Yes.
Yeah. I think just one point to note. I think it's also very important to say that in the budget, every year, at least for the next year, we are going to spend around 9.7 trillion Tanzanian shillings to service debts.
Servicing of the debt. Mama, I give you another
very
chance.
Very complex.
Very quickly, one point or anything?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Well, thank you very much, my panelists. I think I've exceeded a few minutes here. Mr. Director, you'll excuse me for that. It's an interesting topic, and there are so many things which we haven't been able to cover. So, again, thank you very much, my panelists. Viewers, you heard the views of my panelists here. I mean, very interesting about the budget, proposed budget for 2017-2018 framework, which, of course, was presented by the Minister for Finance, in the amount of 31.6 trillion shillings, which is an increase of 2.2 trillion shillings over the 2016-2017 budget, as the Minister of Finance and said. I mean, in his budget framework in the Assembly last time, actually it was in February. The government was able to release only 3.97 trillion shillings out of the 11.8 million shillings approved by the Parliament for development projects in its last budget. Is this a realistic and achievable budget? Well, you have heard from my panelists here the very strong views about it. But many analysts have almost said no, that it is realistic or achievable, and because there are problems of raising the funds. And you remember here I asked the question, where will the money come from? But that has been explained very well. Well, there's the proposal for 2017-2018. Let's hope the government will have heard the views of the members of parliament and the external or analysts as to whether the budget should remain as proposed or they should make some changes in the budget. Let's wait and see. That's all we have for you today. Until next Sunday at 21 hours and on Thursday at 15 hours for the repeat program. On behalf of my panel, Gilead Terry, Professor Haji Semboja, Professor Prosper Ngowi, Dr. Blandina Klama, and TVC Television Crew staff. Thank you very much and bye-bye.